Can. I'm starting video recording just for check, and I pause it now. Pausing. I'm advancing in technology, so I put a quiz as a PDF to your Matala, I would say in English, to your task on Moodle. So you see both of them. So. As you pay attention, our quiz become larger and larger, but I hope I will keep you motivated because I am trying to put into quiz the questions which might appear in the final exam. So it's good for you to get this training. So we have two questions today. First, motivate augmented Lagrangian method graphically with one-dimensional example, as it was in the lecture, and do something on half a page. You don't need to write long explanation, but give idea why it is working. And the question number two, so I get back to, assume we have optimization problem with inequality constraints, and we have augmented Lagrangian. And the claim is that if I put lambda, my optimal Lagrange multipliers, which are part of Karush-Kuntaker conditions, KKT conditions, and then minimize augmented Lagrangian, then optimal solution of entire optimization problem is a minimizer of augmented Lagrangian. Pay attention, I put here belong, because augmented Lagrangian may have more, sometimes more than one minimizer, but at least at the solution, at least the solution problem of entire constraint problem satisfy requirement to be this minimizer. And the hint to solution, you just should write down gradient and equate it to zero. Any question regarding the quiz? So again, your main motivation is that those questions may appear in final exam. So it is very good to try them, and then we maybe will even discuss. So I give you enough time. You have 15 or maybe even 20 minutes from now.
I didn't understand the augmented Lagrangian, you mean P, with the parameters P and mu, or just P? First we learn just P, and then we learn augmented multiplier.
You're asking about question number one?
Yes.
Yes, with two parameters. When we say augmented Lagrangian, we mean not penalty. With only P, we call this penalty function method. And with P and mu, we call it augmented Lagrangian or penalty multiplier method. So augmented Lagrangian with P and mu, give motivation with both P and mu. Okay, so you can start working, and I even will mute my microphone, but I'm responding if you have any questions on the way. We'll pause recording in time. Okay. I hope that my recording is working now, and we will continue with our presentation. Let's see participants. Yes, I see that I'm recording. Okay. I hope you hear me. Please, as usually, respond with voice.
Yes, we can hear.
Hi, Michal.
Thank
you. We can hear you.
Yes. Good morning again. So you finished with quiz. Any questions? Any comments regarding the quiz? Is everything okay? I hope. And we
I have a question.
Yes.
So I didn't understand. I saw the lectures and I didn't understand why we need the slope in which we get. Okay, let's say we are on iteration k, and we get x like in this PDF that is the right.
Just a second. Are you talking about first question or second one?
I think first.
First question.
Yes. Okay. So you are
talking about motivation of the method with one dimensional example. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. We will get to this now, and in the end, if you will still have question, we will discuss. Okay.
Okay, I have another question about question two, but I guess we'll get there later.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Let's wait. You're right. Okay. Just mute your microphones. Okay. So we're coming to the topic of augmented Lagrangian and the penalty multiplier method. I hope that you see both windows normally. Please respond with voice. If you do,
yes.
Okay. So we start with simple problem to minimize some function. It's even linear on this picture. Subject to constraint x less or equal zero. So it left semi-axis. And we in naive way, we do a penalty function phi for x being large and compute some solution as minimizer of penalty aggregate. And then we say that we may do this penalty stronger and stronger. And this will drive this point xp where you have balance between positive derivative of penalty and negative derivative of the objective. This point will move more and more close to actual solution because the minimal value of f under this constraint is achieved, of course, at x equals zero. And now we say, okay, let me move a bit my screen. Just a second. Okay. And so this is penalty method, playing with penalty parameter to make it more and more steep. And penalty multiplier method says a little bit different. Let us introduce such a penalty function which also has slope at the origin which we control. And the slope is equal mu, the derivative at the origin. Yes.
How do we control it to be in the origin?
Okay. So assume that we have a regular penalty function which has a slope one at the origin. Okay. One of examples, it's written here. We just can multiply it by mu. And this will give us other penalty function, which has a derivative mu at the origin.
But, Michael, but in this problem, it's very comfortable that the slope would be changeable at the origin.
Yes.
But you're doing it because in this problem, it's subjected to x smaller or equal to zero. But in another problem, we might want to try it in another point. You know what I'm saying?
We will come to it. To that. Let's understand everything about this very simple constraint. And then we will come to that. The answer to your question in one word, we will apply this penalty to constraints, to our GI, which has the same form, GI less or equal to zero. Remember it. We will apply it to GI, not to X.
Okay, right.
Okay, good. So we have this aggregate, and we say that we start with some reasonable mu. We have this penalty function, and we get this first minimizer x1 bar when mu1 is used parameter in the penalty function. And then we say a very simple thing. Let's in new penalty have this slope like we had here in the origin. Then it will balance our objective function in the origin, because objective function is linear. It's a special example with linear objective function, okay? With non-linear, the story will be a little bit different. And this is what we do. Let me move one slide down. We take the second parameter and the multiplier mu, it exactly says what will be slope in the origin as the slope of previous penalty multiplier function at our solution x1 bar. And this is algorithm. And the x2 will be arg minimum shell of fp mu2 of x. And in this example, we in one iteration, we will get to accurate solution. But pay attention, if f would be nonlinear, then derivative of f will also change. In the origin, it will not be the same as it was at x was bar. So we will not solve the problem, but we will get somehow more close to solution. Any question to this? Yes.
In this algorithm, you don't change the p, just the multiplier?
You may change only multipliers, but the second observation will be when p is reasonably large, all this process will converge faster. So we don't take, for example, just playing with numbers, we don't take p equal 1, but we start with p equal 1 and increase it until it reaches, say, 100 or 1000. And then we continue only updating multipliers. And you will have this as a homework, so you will know this good.
So we change both p, increase p, and change the multiplier to get faster convergence.
At some part of the method. And after you reach, say, p equal 100, you continue with your iterations with update of multipliers, but you stop updating p. Okay, let's move.
Can I ask a question about it?
It is here, maybe. About p, yes?
About the process.
The process is on this slide. It's better to discuss it. You should wait for one more minute. So, and we say that now if we have general optimization problem with inequality constraints, then we will apply our penalty multiplier function. This is scalar function of one variable. So we will apply it to every constraint independently with its own parameter mu. And it will play a role of Lagrange multiplier. So our just a second, I should finish till end of this slide and we will discuss. So the method is minimize in X. So we do our penalty multiplier aggregate, which is written here. We minimize it in X. And then every multiplier mu, we update by its own. It will be phi prime of constraint at previous minimizer. And then we also may increase penalty parameter until it reaches some maximal value. Okay. I see that students continue to send emails. It's not good to send emails while I am talking because I get interruptions from my emailer. Okay, now it's good to discuss. I'm hearing you.
Michael, one question.
Yes.
We add the mu parameter because it it gets harder to solve the problem just with the family of functions phi p. Why does it get harder when the slope gets steeper?
Just a second. You're talking a little bit too close to your microphone, unless you have other ways to
decrease. Can you hear me well now?
Yes. Okay, I understand your question, and you're asking, we're getting really to the first slide, why when this function, usual penalty function, become more and more steep, in the limit it will become like corner. Why it is difficult to minimize the penalty?
Exactly.
And the answer is we do minimization with Newton method, for example. And Newton method uses a second order approximation of our objective function of this FP around current point. And if we have such a corner, second order approximation will not be good. And that's why Newton method will converge very slowly, especially if you immediately start with very large p. Even with penalty function method, you should start increasing it very gradually. Okay, let's get back to our slide. Okay, any other question, comment? Yes.
Yes. So where we in the previous slide, we saw that the slope here in X bar goes to the zero point, right?
To the origin, yes.
In the next iteration.
Yes.
And you said that for a more complex function, it should also be minimized. I mean, here we have a linear function, the slope is constant, so the slope that we get there, this is the slope that we need. And after one iteration, we finish. But I didn't understand why for I don't know, general function that may have in the region of the zero, it may have a very high slope, say. And in any other regions, continuously, of course.
Okay, so I understand you. You say, what if we will have such ill-behaved function?
I
would not jump immediately to extreme, but if instead of f we would have for example some convex function, it will not jump, the slope will not jump, but assume it will be a little bit larger in the origin than it was in the previous, then our minimizer will not be in the origin, but it will be a little bit on the right from the origin. But pay attention, if you will plot here any convex function, you will discover that new minimizer will be somewhere in between x1 and the origin. So in any case, a new minimizer will move a little bit close to the solution.
I have a question.
By hand waving, the answer, but hand waving, you can say that in some sense it's a simple way. You can try with multipliers to apply some higher order methods which take into account more things, and these approaches exist, but the penalty multiplier method, like I explained you now, is really very efficient for very general classes of problems and is widely used. Yes.
I have a question. Let's say in one iteration, the minimum point is inside the right field. I mean, it's smaller than zero.
Yes.
So the mu in this iteration would be close to zero because the derivative of the phi in this point is close to zero. And then next iteration, I will reduce the penalty function because the mu is very small.
I am not sure that you're right, because after first update, you put this derivative into origin. U mu in the origin will be more steep.
But if the
for the second penalty function,
if
it will be more steep than original, and in all this interval, it will be more steep than original mu here.
But if in the previous iteration,
towards the third iteration, it will increase.
But if
maybe I need to put just second to put some picture on the whiteboard. I will remove this stuff. Okay.
Michal, you will stop sharing the screen?
No. We are playing today with new rules. Can you click on my video window and do somehow that you see it larger?
Yes.
Okay, very good.
Very nice.
The best way, if you will be able to see both windows, but maybe you can, I'm really asking to discuss in your Facebook group and whatever, to find the options to put two windows of large size. Maybe it's not now. Now you can only try to do it like switching on your screen. But hopefully.
Michael,
yes.
Just take into account that the recording will probably not show.
No. I took care about the recording. I hope that my recording will show. But also there is a backup recording of the students who succeeded to do two large windows. I hope that it will show.
Beautiful.
At least I played yesterday and it did something good. Okay.
I hope it records what I'm saying. I'm not sure about that.
Yeah. Yes. We will see. Okay. So. Assume that I have a first penalty function, and I have this x1 bar. And if I copy this slope, I have this second penalty function, which has larger slope here, but everywhere on this interval, it has larger slope than it was in x bar, because it has the slope like it was in x bar here in the origin and in all other places larger. So if I have my intermediate minimizer at any point, the third slope will be even larger. I am not sure that I will put it right on this picture, but you understand the idea. So this is phi, I will skip. P mu 1, this is phi mu 2, and so on. From this example, you see that we really will have sequence of increasing multipliers until they really will move our solution close to x1. But if you let me finish, but if your slope was too large of your objective and you failed here, the story will be opposite. Then in the origin you will get smaller slope for new penalty, and if you are still here you will get even smaller. And then you have two possibilities: or your point will drive to the origin if it is active constraint, or it will stay in the negative area. I can put here even not x but gi constraint gi, and then it will stay And the multiplier will become smaller and smaller until it reaches zero. Yes, I'm with you.
I'm referring to the second case that you mentioned, that the slope is getting lower.
Yes.
There are possibility that in the next iteration I would get again the optimal point on the right side, and then I will do like
you mean it will oscillate. Yes.
Yes, exactly.
In one-dimensional example, if my objective function, for example, is not linear but convex, f of x. If it is convex, you can show that new point will not jump we should think about this, but I hope that you may show that the point will not write on the right hand side. I even can leave it to you as a challenge. See, similar as we told that if it is on the right hand side, yes, it will remain there in between. Similar story should be about negative part, but I may leave it for your own home consideration. And I should tell you one more thing, that you are very right about asking those questions. There is a special theory how to prove convergence of those methods. They are based on duality, on dual representation of optimization problems, which we will learn in the next lecture. And if one is interested, I have a video which demonstrates idea of this proof. Okay, we are close to the break, and maybe we will try to finish with this one-dimensional case. Let's see. Can we continue? Okay, let's continue. So we have this general flow of the method. And this special penalty function, which we like to use, which was part of my PhD thesis in the time. Okay, and let's discuss equality constraints after the break. So it's very good point to make break 10 minutes, unless you have any questions. Any comments up to this slide?
Michael, just for yes. A future question, just in the next, after the break, if we can solve question number two, since the quiz is over and you talked about it in the lecture.
Yes, we will come to it. And I am very glad you are very energetic. After you solve quiz, your attention is really concentrated on the question. We will do it. We will do it together.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, see you in 10 minutes. Okay. We are back from our break. And do you hear me? Is anybody back?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, we hear you.
Yes, we hear you.
Okay. So we considered this general augmented Lagrangian scheme. And then we told the penalty function may be exponential, but it's better to use this kind of quadratic logarithmic, because more quadratic you have, better it's for Newton method to minimize the final function. And you will use this kind of function in your homework. And then we say that for equality constraints, by the way, it's no need to raise your hand because I'm not following. You can I allow you to tell with voices you if you have any questions on the way. Okay, then for equality for equality constraints, with penalty function method we have usual penalty, quadratic function. But the problem that its slope in the origin is zero. So if we multiply it by anything, it continues to be zero. The trick is that we use the sum of quadratic plus linear term with slope mu and the slope of resulting quadratic function. If you will drive all this together, you will get some other parabola which passes through origin and has its minimum somewhere on the left, and then it increases again. But importantly, its slope at the origin will be mu. And then we may have similar story. We have our objective function plus sum of penalty multiplier function of equality constraints. But if we open those two terms, we get a very nice expression where we have a Lagrangian. We have objective function plus sum of coefficients mu I multiplied by h I, which is written here, plus penalty. And this is one more reason why the method is called augmented Lagrangian, because historically it was developed actually for this equality constraint. Problems. Yes, any question, any comment at this point?
So the edge that we will get in the optimal solution will be less than zero, right?
No, it should be zero. We have constraint h equals zero. So if we will fall on the right hand side, as usually we will increase our multiplier by the updating, maybe I have in the next slide. Yes, if h, for example, is positive at some iteration, yes, you see the formula for I did some jump for answering your question. We need to look on this slide and then we will answer. So. If I have this function, penalty multiplier function, I can write its derivative. Here's its derivative. And our update formula, like we say, that new multiplier is derivative of this penalty multiplier function at previous minimizer. If we substitute this expression, we get an even more simple formula. It's new multiplier is old multiplier plus penalty parameter multiplied by the value of this penalty function at the previous minimizer. And now we understand. If, for example, our penalty function was positive, yes, h was positive, the new multiplier will be larger, so we will increase our penalty for positive function and will drive more forcibly in direction of zero. And if it on the left hand side, we will decrease our multiplier, so it will allow it to go to in the direction of zero. Yes, now I am with you, or maybe you already got answer.
Yeah, I got my answer now.
Okay. Okay, any other questions? We will continue. Any question? Okay, no question. We will continue. Actually, I am thinking what to do at this point. We have this very important part ADMM, alternating direction method of multipliers, but before, maybe we will get to this question which was in the quiz.
Let's do the quiz.
Yes, yes. I'm coming then. I'm with you. Okay. And we say that if we have augmented Lagrangian, unfortunately, I don't have it written here. I have already its derivatives. If I have augmented Lagrangian in the way that my multipliers in the penalty function are optimal Lagrange multipliers, and I minimize it, I minimize my penalty aggregate in X. So I get to this solution where its gradient, which is written here, is zero. And we should understand what will happen. Assume that we are staying at the optimal point, x zero. And we know that the gradient of usual Lagrangian should be zero at this point. It's not written on this slide, so I will write it on the whiteboard. Because it's very important question. Okay. So I have Lagrangian. Just a second, get better pen. Lagrangian of x lambda is objective function f of x plus sum lambda I gi of x. I will remove this. Gi of x. Okay. To be sure that my whiteboard looks well, I minimize just a second. This camera will be okay. I just minimize. Wow, it is not focusing fast enough. Now it's better. Wow, it come to auto, aggressive autofocus, this camera. Okay. And now, so my optimality condition, of course, it's zero is gradient with respect to x, L of x star lambda star, f of x star plus sum of lambda I gi of x star, lambda I star as well. Lambda I star. Okay. Wow. Something happened. Camera became very active with changing focus. I will maybe even move it a little bit closer.
Okay, now.
Yes. Wow. Okay.
Isn't it supposed to be the derivative and the gradient of f?
Gradient, yes. Gradient.
And derivative of g.
And gradients. Gradients of g. Gradients of gi. Yeah, thank you very much. Okay. And now.
Michael, can you try to tilt?
Where was my camera?
Yeah.
It needs maybe a brighter pen to do better focusing. I will look for. Do you have writer plan. Check this one. Oh, maybe this one is great. Okay. And now we have FP maybe. I even will not write this P. F of X lambda. It's objective function f of x plus some phi mu. I just skip parameter p. Phi mu of gi x. Okay. And now I write, of course, it's gradient f. Sorry, gradient of f with respect to x. It's gradient of f of x plus some phi mu prime of gi. Multiplied by gradient of GI. Okay, now I have those two conditions, GI of X. Now I have those two conditions, and let's try to compare them. If I place myself to the optimal point, to the solution of my problem. I didn't put here argument, so I put here GI star. Value of constraints at the optimal point. And here I also put X star. Okay. You know. Let me open here. Phi prime, phi mu I, yes, prime of g I of x star multiplied by this. Okay, I compare those two records, yes. This one with this one. Are they equal? If I will get to the conclusion that those expressions are equal, I will get immediately that gradient will be zero, gradient of my penalty multiplier function. Okay. Of course, gradient of objective function at x star here and here is.
Michael, I think you should better replace the mu by lambda. Because it's just confusing. Here you
okay. Yes, because thank you very much. Because I had lambda here. You're right. Lambda I. And here lambda I. Thank you. Lambda I. Okay. And what I will take freedom. I will remove this in order to have easier comparison between those two lines. And I say that this and this is the same. Okay? Equal. And also this and this is the same. Also equal. I only need to compare this with this, and I say, and I should put here gradient of f of x star lambda star. That's why I will put here lambda I star, and I say. If my constraint is active, it means that it is zero at the solution. then I built my penalty function, penalty multiplier function in the way that its derivative is the origin exactly is equal to its parameter, lambda I. So this is equal for active constraint. What will happen with non-active constraint? For non-active constraint, lambda I is zero. What will happen with my penalty function? Here is phi lambda as function of GI. Phi lambda I as function of GI. If I would have some slope lambda I, of course, if lambda I would be not zero, it would have some slope. What happens if lambda I is zero with this function? It has zero slope at the origin. And then I built it in the way that it is monotonic. It is monotonically increasing. So the only possibility I have, or it should be zero everywhere. It cannot go in this way. On the right hand side, it should be zero or may increase, but on left hand side, I know that it is zero everywhere.
Right can get down.
Because why cannot it go down? Because it is convex. I built a phi in the way that it convex and monotonic. If okay, it would be go in this way, this is non-convex orbit.
Yes, okay, but okay. This is what I want to know.
So if I know that its slope at the origin is zero, and it is convex and monotonically not decreasing, so the only possibility is that it's zero everywhere. So, and if my constraint is non-GI star, non-active means it is negative in it is negative when x g I would say gi star gi of x star it is negative, it cannot be positive because positive would violate the constraint. My constraints are gi less or equal zero, yes? So for active constraint, it's equal zero at the solution point. For non-active constraint, it's smaller than zero. And because my function built in this way, I get to to conclusion that phi prime lambda I is zero for GI of X star less than zero. Okay, so I get everything exactly as in Lagrangian. So I have exactly the same expression, and I know that gradient of Lagrangian is zero. That's why gradient of my penalty multiplier method is also zero. Any question? Okay, then we finished with this part, and let's
Michael, can you do this for a little second for so we can screenshot the what you wrote?
Okay, you can try.
That's it. Thank
hopefully
you.
It will remain on the video, but you can. Did anybody do already screenshot? It's enough that one person did it. Then you may share with others, and hopefully it will work. You know, I even will do my own picture of this slide. Just a second. I will do my own scan of this slide. Okay. Okay. So now we're coming to another very important topic, which is alternating direction method of multiplies. This technique became really, really popular in recent 5 or 8 years in very many large scale application in image signal processing, even neural networks and many other areas. And there is a professor in Stanford, Stephen Boyd, who wrote a very nice article about this. Think in this way. And who is interested in the topic should look for his very nice review article on this topic. So, and the methods has says the following: assume that our objective is separable. Instead of having long variable X, we have two groups of variables, X and Z. And we have function of X plus other function of Z. And we have constraints, usually it's linear constraint. Some function of H and Z is equal zero. If H is linear, actually the constraint is also separable. You can put it as a sum of two functions. And of course, we already learned augmented Lagrangian for such kind of problem. Here is our objective function. And we take our Lagrange multiplier. The only difference is y here instead of lambda. sum of yi multiplied by constraints, hi plus penalty term of constraints. This is really the same as was in my lecture. And the special about this method, usually we minimize augmented Lagrangian in our original variables. It would be X and Z together and then update multipliers. But what people say that in many cases, you can do two sequential minimization, one in X and the other in Z, and then update multipliers by usual formula. And this is ADMM method, which you already watched the video, I hope. Any question, any comment at this point?
Michael, you say the constraint is linear here, yes? The H
yes, people, I just wrote to save writing in this general form. People write here instead of matrix A multiplied by X plus matrix B multiplied by Z minus some constant vector is zero, yes.
So it's linear and separable because linear, okay.
Because linear is automatically separable, yes. But for the record, it's convenient to write in this notation because it immediately brings you back to the notation of our augmented Lagrangian, more general augmented Lagrangian. And I will keep it with this notation in the following. In contrast to the literature that you will meet, that you'll write this explicitly, but it will not add anything to exposition of the method. Okay. And very important examples, so-called lasso or basis pursuit problem. For example, I want to find least square solution of system of linear equation. A is a matrix, X is a vector. AX minus B second norm square, plus some penalty, sum of absolute values of components of X, L1 norm of X with some coefficient. lambda, why people add this penalty term? Because if there is a freedom, if I have many potential candidates for solution, for example, if the system is strongly underdetermined, or maybe I agree to get solution with some residual, which is not exactly zero. This penalty term will enforce my solution to be sparse, mean most of components of X will be zero, and only a small portion of them will be non-zero. And this is very popular technique in signal image processing, inverse problems, and many other applications. And we will see that Lasse will help us to solve this problem.
Michal, just a question. Isn't it better to do this kind of constraint for sparsity with two norm, to leave it convex?
First of all, this is also convex. It's only the problem, it's not smooth. And people will find this is a topic of additional discussion, that if I will put here two norm, mean sum of squares of x's. First of all, traditionally people used this regularization. It's called with other names, so called Tikhonov regularization. It was extremely popular. And then about say 30 years ago, people understood that this kind of term, it's maybe very useful. Why? Because if you are close to zero with some components of X, quadratic penalty become very, very flat. It almost doesn't penalize. So it still allows X to have some small entries, to have some noise around zero. And this one norm penalty will really clean it up well. And that's why it works very well for denoising, for example.
Okay.
Really on 1 foot, very fast explanation. And the trick to solve it with ADMM is to introduce artificial variable Z. And we have constraint that X and Z should be the same. It's very artificial trick, but it works. So, and instead of one norm of X, we put here one norm of Z. And one can, I remind here my general notion on the problem, yes, which I look on ADMM. And this particular problem, which we solved for last one. So to solve with ADMM, first of all, we build augmented Lagrangian. I remind you, we take our objective function, this f plus g, plus multipliers multiplied by constraint plus penalty term. So what is our f? First function which depends only on x, it's here. So we put it here. What is our term dependent on z? G of z, it's here. Plus y transpose multiplied by constraint. H is x minus z. So I put here x minus z. And also, instead of h squared, I put this term. It's everything clear. And now I remind myself the algorithm. So I should minimize first in x, and then minimize in z, and then update multipliers. And what I propose you now as a class exercise, do the first thing. Write only terms in this objective function which depends on x. Actually, those are those three terms, yes? The first one, this one, and this one. And write down gradient with respect to x and equate it to zero. and then we will get then we will get analytically the result of this step. You can start working. We will succeed today only this part, and we will see maybe okay, we will succeed only with this part today. Unfortunately, we're a little bit slow. Okay, start working and raise your voice if anybody will be ready with this to show us. Okay.
Maybe I'll
started recording this. Okay.
Okay.
We are with Ron.
Okay, so this is our objective function. And its dependence on X is with three terms, the first, the third, and the fourth.
Just a second.
Okay.
Just a second. I'm still struggling with my Zoom. Here, participants. Okay. I'm with you.
Can you see my screen?
You can do a little smaller your word than okay. Maybe for some reason on my screen left. Okay. Yes, I do. Okay.
So I will get back to the explanation. We have the objective function and its dependence on X is with three terms.
Mm-hmm.
Now we will start by taking the gradient with respect to X.
Mm-hmm.
So the second term will be equal to zero.
Mm-hmm.
It's a straightforward calculation. You're welcome to verify my derivation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I would also like to remind that P is positive.
Mm-hmm.
It is the multiplication factor. Now I am equating for X. So X is on left hand side and the rest is on the right hand side.
Mm-hmm.
And I use something that is important. We have, first of all, a Gram matrix, A transpose A. It is positive semi-definite for every matrix A.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I mentioned that P is positive, which sums up to a positive definite matrix on the left side.
Yes, you're so right.
It definitely has an inverse, mm-hmm. and I multiply both sides by the inverse and get a relation, an equation for X.
I see there is a remark from Sapir. Sapir, we have rule. We participate with voice. You can tell with voice your remarks.
Yeah, I read it in the first line. It looks like it's a transpose כפול b. שלא עבר את הצד.
כן.
נכון, שכחתי את העבר הזה.
כן.
Transpose b. תודה רבה.
Yeah, A transpose B on the...
תודה רבה. אז...
you can... subtract it or add it? B was with minus.
Yeah. That's right. Thank you. Edit. here, and I will also need to edit, obviously.
And I hope that you verified it with the lecture and it is okay. We will see it immediately now in my slides. A transpose B minus PZ. I have for some reason minus, wow. I have two differences, minus rho I. Maybe I have some mistake in my recordings. Okay, I should verify my slides. Okay, we will leave it for the homework. Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Would you like me to stop sharing?
Yes, yes, you can stop sharing. And I will start sharing my window. And to go to the second part, I suggest you to look to some auxiliary problem. I will share my screen now. Share. I hope that you see now. Let me increase a bit my video. Do you see? I hope that you see my screen sharing. Yes?
Yes, I can see soft thresholding.
Soft thresholding. And this is a very important auxiliary task which is used to solve the second part, minimization in Z. And the minimization in Z will have this kind of terms. So that's why we now can consider a problem in one variable. In this example, X is a scalar variable. And this is says the following physical consideration. Assume I have a point U. And I have a penalty how far I can move from the U. But also I have penalty on my solution that I want its absolute value to be as small as possible. So I have this kind of objective function. 1/2 x minus u squared plus some parameter lambda multiplied by absolute value of x. And I invite you to find solution. What will be minimizer of this problem? It looks a little bit challenging because of this absolute value. That's why one can start, just assume that everything is positive. Also u is positive, also x is positive. So I can remove absolute value from consideration. And let's start from this very simple problem and just write down solution and say with voice when you are ready. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, thank you. Just to hear the communication is working. So it's very simple question. If you are ready, raise your hand or even say it by voice. You just, I want to minimize this in X. I just write down derivative with respect to X and equate it to zero. And this will give me immediately solution. X is a function of U.
It is a straightforward.
Very good. Yes. And I just will move in my slide, yes. So you equate it to zero. And you get this solution, yes? X is u minus lambda, yes?
Yes. Yes.
But what will happen if lambda is large? You will get here a negative value, yes?
Yes.
But I am coming back to my original problem. Let me increase a little bit my window. I will come to play a little bit with my windows. Let me do it larger. I will come to my original problem. I want to find some of those two functions. From a physical consideration, from intuitive consideration, I understand when u is positive, the minimum of those two cannot be negative. I have no force which drives it to the left-hand side. In contrast to the situation, if inside of absolute value of x would be really x, yes, like it here, I would get negative solution. That's why I conclude if u is positive, this is my solution. It means that for large lambda, my solution will be enforced to be exactly zero. I'm not sure how clear I explained this, but this is very important point in the soft thresholding procedure. So I claim that minimizer of this function for large lambdas will give me zero. And this why this kind of penalty enforces zero, enforces sparse solutions. So I add the here index plus. Did you see ever index plus with some expression? It means if this expression is positive, it remains positive. And if it is negative, I substitute it with zero. And here I made this graphical in this right plot. So I have this expression for x bar, and if if lambda is not very large, I will stay on this. If I plot u minus lambda, yes? What is u minus lambda? What is plot of this linear function u minus lambda? When u equal lambda, it will be zero. So it starts from here, and for larger u, it goes in this way. But when it tries to become negative, I substitute it with zero and use have this kind of plot. Are you with me?
Yes.
Yes.
A little bit challenging, but it's very important. So my claim that solution for positive u has this kind of dependence, how x bar, how minimizer will change if I change u in this function. And of course, by symmetry consideration, if I have negative u, I will get the same kind of plot, only in negative direction. And this function has special name. It's called soft thresholding function. And you will meet in the lecture. And now, how can
Michael, just how did we get to the soft thresholding function?
Okay.
Well,
okay, I consider this problem to minimize the function which has these two terms. And I ask how minimizer of this function, x bar, I denoted x bar, will depend on this parameter u as a function of u. I wrote up optimality condition, and for a really large u, I will get this linear function. But I also know if I minimize some of those this parabola plus absolute value, when u is positive, my solution may be on this interval or maybe at zero. So it will be at zero. Here I have analytic expression. It will be zero when u is equal lambda. So I have this linear part, and it will reach zero. But it will not go negative. When my u is positive, it will not go negative. So it will stay zero. I have this branch. It's very important for people who will learn sparse representations and sparse methods in image and signal processing. Okay. And then similar work, intellectual work, I may do for negative u and get the same kind of symmetric kind of answer. This part I leave for you.
No, it was clear. I just asked why do we solve this problem?
Why do you solve this problem? It's very good question. How people who do presentation categorize questions? They say excellent question if it will be used in the next slide. So the answer, it will be used in the next slide.
Okay.
Because now I will bring you back to the problem. Let's minimize my augmented Lagrangian in Z. I have augmented Lagrangian here. I want to minimize it in Z. It's as the second point in ADMM, in alternating direction method of multipliers. Okay, so to minimize it in Z, I consider this term plus this term plus this term. And pay attention that this function is separable. In every, it's here it's sum of absolute value of Zi. Here is a sum of Zi multiplied by Yi. You can not think about this constant term. Y by X doesn't influence solution. It's some linear term. And here is another quadratic term. So I have this function actually of every component of Zi. I may write it on the whiteboard because it's important. What do I have? Just a second, I need wider pen because it start doing defocus aggressively. I have in my slide absolute value of Zi. Plus minus yi multiplied by zi. Yes, this I will focus my camera. This I get from the second term in the augmented Lagrangian. Yes, from here. Are you with me?
Yes, Michal, but why? But you have not substituted the optimal x.
I don't care about x. My minimization in Z here, will not depend on x. I would need to substitute optimal x here. And let's denote as x bar. So I have the third term it's rho divided by 2, plus or minus? Plus, yes?
Plus.
Rho divided by 2. And here x bar, optimal x, I, minus zi. And I invite you, well, now it's okay, yes? I invite you to solve this problem in one variable.
Michael, but again, the optimal x depends on z.
Just a second. You may assume that you already know this optimal. It depends and in z. Thank you. It's a very good question. But what algorithm does, it takes some current z, yes, and minimize everything in x. And then when we minimize it in z, we already substitute. If you see my pointer, do you see my pointer on the slide?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We substitute the x, which was a result of this previous step. We don't change it anymore. And this is the essence of ADMM in contrast to usual augmented Lagrangian.
So z is also constant? The z which is for x optimal?
When we minimize in x, we take z constant and y constant. We minimize in one variable, fixing all others. And this is what we did in the first minimization. We just removed this z, yes, from the consideration. And the same, it's very good. Thank you very much for your questions. They are very important. And then we minimize in z, assuming that x is constant. And that's why we, and now we can do it analytically. In the same way, in very similar way, like we did for iterative thresholding. I just will put the slide. Now you don't need the slide on ADMM because we wrote our objective function, which we want to minimize in X, minimize in Z, yes? Minimize it in Z.
Michael, just to make sure, after you find the optimal z, you substitute it into the expression for the optimal x.
No, I do everything independently. It will be on the new iteration. In the new iteration, I will. It goes in this way. Let me switch back to the algorithm flow. I minimize in x, keeping z and y as constants. Then I minimize in z, keeping x and y as constant. Then I update multipliers, and then I go again to the first step.
Okay.
And this is flow of the method.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, and now we will do this second step. We will minimize in z our augmented Lagrangian, and we already wrote on the whiteboard what it will be for every variable. And now you have this auxiliary function. You know to minimize this kind of function, yes? You already know. You can try to transform this expression into this more simple form, yes? To have a square with something with 1/2. And something multiplied. Now instead of x, you only will use z. Okay, this is your second challenge. How many people stay with me? Okay, 7 people. You are very good. Thank you.
Thank you, as well.
Yeah, six people, 7 including myself.
Okay.
Very good. And we will leave it for all other students. You do very helpful work. Okay. So try to solve this problem and just say with voice when you're ready.
Michael, maybe we should add lambda before the absolute value of Zi.
You are right. Thank you very much. Jessica, oh, my defocusing is really aggressive. Let's see here. Yes, Lambda, you are right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Because of here, yes, on the slide.
Yes.
Sorry, it should be Lambda. Yeah. You're right. It should be Lambda. Z-I. Okay. No, I don't know why my camera becomes so aggressively refocusing.
There is an alternative. Instead of alternating the camera, maybe you can alternate the board, tilt the board a little bit.
Move it a little bit.
Yeah. Right? Yes. Exactly.
Is it in focus now? It's not really in focus.
Not 100% in focus.
Okay. Let me do something else. Let me help to the focusing system. No, I need brighter pen.
Okay, focused.
It helped, yeah?
Yeah.
So we need we learn something else. No. Okay. Yeah. Go ahead. And let me know when you're ready. And I will pause recording, but please remind me. Recording. Okay. I hope that my recording is working. So I should stop my screen share. Let me stop it. Okay. I stopped my screen share. And you,
okay.
You can start yours.
Just a second. I just did per one element.
So yes.
Yeah. So this is my function F. I denoted lambda by L because it's just simpler.
Okay.
For me.
Okay.
So here I'm finding the derivative. So mm-hmm. So this is the derivative, and I equate it to zero, and yes. I find Zi.
But you have problem. You have Zi on both sides. Yes.
Yes, I know. But no, I mean that if you take a positive Zi, so you.
Yes. Okay. Let's consider for a moment positive Zi. Okay.
So sine Zi is one.
Yes.
This.
And what do you get?
אגב, שחסר לך מינוס בגזירה שלה בריבוע, נגזרת הפנימית, מינוס אחד.
You are right.
Because you can do in the way you are doing, but there is a okay. So what is your conclusion?
What I just have to change some minus stuff here because of it. What is my conclusion? So we also should put here plus at the end, because we assume positive.
For positive Zi, we will use plus of this expression, yes? Mm-hmm. With index, this is, or maximum between this expression and zero, yes?
Yes, so I will put plus here.
Okay.
Second and this.
Okay. This is if the Zi. Okay. maximum between the but it's okay because we already have this not you can leave it in this way. Okay. It's when Zi is when Zi is greater than zero, yes?
Yes, I can.
Actually when not when Zi but when not with so you assume Zi is greater than zero but you are not given Zi so it it requires you are moving in good direction but it requires a little bit clean up, yes, because what yeah. we are given not Zi but Xi, yes, and Zi will be result of our consideration. But you have also a yi, so you need to understand when it is positive on or not. And but you are in good direction. And let's see. Thank you very much for sharing. Or you want to? At this point, it's okay. And I will try to share my screen. Get back to my slides. I hope I will be able to do it. I hope that this is right window. Just a second, I will close the door. One second, I'm back. Sorry. The idea is following. We can denote this function as with some notation. And let's see what ADMM suggests us. This function, I am jumping to solution because we got enough motivation to get it. We denote this function, the solution of my thresholding problem, as S lambda of u, this function which we had on in this. We call this function S lambda of u. Okay, and this solves this kind of problem: x minus something squared plus absolute value of x. So what one can do? One can try to take our problem and. And write instead.
Excuse me, Michael.
Z minus. Okay, sorry.
I just have to leave, and I want to update you that I stopped the recording.
Okay.
If you need it, just contact me. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, and bye-bye.
Okay, goodbye. Thank you for participating. Okay, so what we actually have, or maybe, you know, I can leave you for your home consideration. You should move this to the form of z minus some say 1/2 z minus some u squared plus what it was lambda just a second plus lambda absolute value of z plus lambda absolute value of z. lambda bar, some other lambda. So we can take this expression and only ask what will be u and what will be lambda bar to have this kind of problem. And this kind of problem we already solved. We have this soft thresholding solution like is here. Okay, I am giving you only bold hints. Of course, we have a name of this function, soft thresholding function, S lambda. And bottom line, this is the formula you are supposed to get. This also may have some small minor mistakes with sign. And that's all. This is the result of our second step. And the update of multipliers, it's straightforward. It's old multiplier plus raw multiplied by constraint. And constraint is here. Yes. Okay. And this more or less. I feel that I leave you some opening to clean this up, but I guess we get rather well the ideas in which direction it should go. Okay, thank you very much. Any question, any point, any comment at this point?
Michal, I have some, I just wanted to ask. At this lecture, we continued another hour, yes? I wanted okay. to ask that in general, in the reception hour, in general, is there some important material that we should know about? Because, or it was just for once, like we continued.
Yeah, it's only once. It's only once because it was a very long quiz and arrangements in the beginning. Usually, also we try to keep it recording. It's very useful. You're active participants. You're actually participating usually in the reception hours, but it's a good idea to check what was recorded there because we go through material. But it's I hope this is the only one that we really included material of the class in the third hour.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for your patience today. Okay, okay.
Thank
okay,
you.
So we finished, or something else? Any comment, question?
Just wanted to say that if you have recording of the whole lecture, and I pause on the break, so if you need, let me know.
Okay. I hope that my recording will work. If not, then I will ask you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, and have a good week.